the opportunity for an audience Q&A and engagement with you all. So please, as I say, include your Q&A in the box that we've got at the bottom of the platform. Jasmine, if you could just close that poll now, that would be helpful. Thank you. It looks like we've got the majority of people with us are from an audit firm. So 56% from an audit firm. So that's helpful for us to know. Okay, so next slide, please. Okay, so without further delay, let's begin with the opening remarks. And we're going to start with Monica Forster, who's the chair of IFAC's SMP Advisory Group. Monica will be followed by Salvador Marin, who's the EFAA president. So, Monica, if I could please ask you to make some remarks. Thank you.
Chris, thank you very much. And good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. I would like to thank IFAC, the IAASB, and the EFAA for organizing this webinar. And I thank all of our participants for taking the time to lend us their insights. We have a great attendance today with over 3,000 registered from over 150 different countries, which demonstrates the importance of this project and the substantial level of global interest on the team. Less complex entities make a significant contribution to the global economy in every country, both in their own right and as essential links in the global supply chain. In an increasingly complex reporting and audit environment, it is crucial that we find the right path forward for audits of less complex entities. This concerns investors, regulators, and all stakeholders across society. And of course, it has enormous significance for professional accountants, our organizations, and our clients. As chair of IFAC's Small and Medium Practices, or SMP Advisory Group, we have been closely following and supporting this extremely important project. This has included formally responding to the IAASB consultations and providing regular input from the SMP and small and medium enterprises entities perspective as the project has progressed. We have consistently advocated for exploring possible actions to address the challenges and concerns raised in applying the ISAs to less complex entities. Recently, we have focused on the development of a high-quality separate LCE standard, which we believe should be high priority for the IAASB. The need for action at the global level is especially clear given the significant risk of fragmentation in the international standards setting ecosystem. There is a lot to consider here, probably too much to fit in this hour of conversation. But it's great to have this opportunity to provide an update to global stakeholders on the progress being made by the IAASB as they look to finalize the standard later this year. So many thanks again, and over directly to you, Salvador, for your initial remarks.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Monica. I appreciate to you again in one even more, and the rest of the panelists and the members, of course. Thank you so much for this opportunity. Welcome, everyone. The European Federation of Accountants and Auditors for Small and Medium-Sized Enterprise, EFAA for SMEs, we are the primary voice to small and medium-sized practice in Europe. It's proud, especially proud to be co-hosting this event with the International Audit and Assurance Standard Board and the International Federation of Accountants. Extremely places to see that there are more participants in this event than any other online event that IFA, the EASB of IFA, have ever previously held. I understand over 3,000 registers for today. I suppose that everyone they are with us today together. That it of itself tells you how important the topic of today, the audio of less complex entities, essentially SMEs, is for the global accountancy profession, as Monica has mentioned. No, let me share with you IFA views of the ESV project to develop an international standard of audits for less complex entity. This project is perhaps the most important project of the ESV since the Clarity project of 2004-2007. Thought sustainability reporting assurance that Lou said to Trump even this project. I know very well because we are spending a lot of time in the sustainability reporting assurance, but now, today, our more important project is this project that we are speaking today. This project is critical to the future of the SMEs, how they arise fundamental question about the form and nature of international standard. We therefore strongly support the ESVS4. We applaud it for its intent, the highly consultative process of development, and this rapid progress today. No, the ESB plans to approve the final standard by the end of this year, less than 3 years since it approved the project proposal. I suppose it is the fastest draft the ESB has ever produced a new international standard on auditing. And of course, I am sure we will work to ensure that the regulators, professional accounting organizations, small and medium-sized practitioners, and the wider public understand that this standard will provide the basis for an audit of equivalent quality to an audit perfect using the international standard audit. This is important to remark this last sentence that I have mentioned. No? IFA has witnessed SMMPs struggle for years to apply international standard audits, despite the substantive effort by the ESB, IFAC, professional accounting organization, software producer, commercial producer of guidance, and other. While the ES international standard on auditing are technically robust, it is clear, especially writing and presenting, they are, in our opinion, they are not scalable. Inevitably, IFA concluded long ago that the international standard on audits were only fit for the audit or larger, more complex, no? More complex public interest entity by large practice. No? This is why there is an urgent need for international standard on auditing for less complex entity. And now we are close to having one. And so now it's time to prepare for its publication. We are very happy for that, no? This project promises many things to ensure the viability of the less complex entity audit, to serve the public interest by fostering trust and confidence in SME financial statements, and it's important to help build the profession in emerging economies. IFA, in general, our member organizations, our board member, everybody in IFA, we are very happy to see the direction of the project. No, we welcome the decision in December 2020 to develop a truly scalable, separate, and standalone standard. And the standard based on the same fundamental principle as the international standard on audits, no? And more recently, just more last month, we will call the scope of the international standard audit for less complex entity being extended to include audits or less complex entity groups. It's another important point for us. As I told you, today is an important day for our accountancy profession. No? Friends, colleagues, to closely me, welcome you all to this event. And Chris, over to you.
Thanks so much, Salvador. Thank you, Monica, as well. So let's move, if we can, to the next slide, please, Jasmine. And I have the real pleasure of introducing the IAASB team. So we have with us today Kai Morton-Hagen, who is an IAASB board member and chair of the LCE Task Force. We have Jasper van der Hoot, an IAASB principal, and Amy Fairchild, also an IAASB principal. So thanks so much, team, for being with us. Hopefully you will be able to take us through a great update to where you are on this project. I'll hand over to you, Kai, to get started. Thanks.
Thank you, Chris. Good morning, good evening, and good afternoon to everyone on this webinar. Very happy to be here, and thanks to IFAC and EFAA to organize this event so we can share some insights into how this project is evolving. So thanks for that. As you said, Amy and Jasper is with me on this presentation, and we will share, divided in three parts, give a little bit of the background to the project. Then we'll also talk a little bit what we heard in the consultation and how we're progressing towards the final standard. So as been highlighted by some of the other participants by Monica and Salvador in the beginning, this is an important project. It's an important project for us as IAASB as well. The IAASB's remit is to set robust global standard in the public interest to enable high quality audits that will build trust in financial and non-financial reporting. As been highlighted by others, the operating and reporting environment structures and transactions have over the years become more and more complex, and has also then led to the ISAs becoming increasingly longer and more complex. In addition, there has been a focus on protecting capital markets, which has also led to some of the additional requirements in the ISAs has been focused towards protecting capital markets. That has led to the ISAs becoming complex to implement and use for less complex audits, which is also some of the what we're trying to address here. We've seen that a number of jurisdictions have started to develop their own standards. Some have done and implemented, some have started doing the work on exploring how to do that. And there is a risk of global divergence and fragmentation, which is not good for any of us. I think our profession and audit in general, we have the pleasure of having global standards that are mostly used throughout the world, and that is of a great help for us. This project started based on long discussions, and we had a discussion paper in 2019 around less complex entities and what to do. In addition to that, with the outreach did, we in 2020 agreed on a project proposal to develop a standard. We developed the ED within less than a year. So it was released the summer of 2021. And the objective, what we're doing, is to have a separate standard designed for audits of LCEs, to have high quality audit that could instill the confidence and trust in this part of the economy as well. As been highlighted by Monica, less complex entities make a critical contribution to the world economy and account for a great number of entities around the world. So maintaining confidence in the financial reporting of LCEs is important and is something that we're trying to address through this project. We'll help auditors of the LCEs undertake consistent, effective, high quality audits by having more streamlined and targeted requirements that are directed and appropriate for audits of LCEs. As we've seen through outreach and the EDs, it's being responsive to what stakeholders are asking for. And by having a global international standard, separate four audits of less complex entities will promote consistent application of standards in this area as well. So if I can have the next slide. As you know, the basis for this standard is that we'll have a separate standalone standard to enable high quality audit. As been highlighted by Salvador in the beginning as well, the objective of this standard is to reach the same level of assurance as we have with the ISAS. It's not a lower level standard. It's not, we don't have any compromises when it comes to quality, but it's to develop a standard specifically for this group. Standalone means that the standard should be able to be used on its own. It does not include any references back to the ISAS for any requirements. All necessary requirements and essential explanatory material needed are included in the standard itself. It doesn't mean that the ISAS is not helpful. They could be helpful. You know the ISAS today, and they could be a good source of information also in the future, but the standard on its own should be able to stand on its own. It's developed as an alternative. IAASB cannot say that this standard is that you cannot use the ISAS for this group. So we're developing this as an alternative. So you can either use the ISAS or you could use the separate standard. As I said, it has the same level of assurance in the report. So the users of the audit report and the financial statement should have the same trust in the financial reporting as they do under the ISAS. We've done this through basing the standard on the underlying concepts that is also used in the ISAS, and we've adapted them as appropriate to the nature of the audit and in the standard. We focused on what's the core procedures, so we've not gone into all the level of detail that you may have in the ISAS themselves. That should be proportionate to the circumstances of an audit of an LCE. But there is also, in some areas, there may be more level of details than in others, depending on what's proportionate to the LCE audits. So if I can have the next slide, thank you. With the exposure draft, as I said, that was released in summer of 21, we did lots of roundtables and presentation and LinkedIn live sessions. This project is an enormous project. It was done during the COVID lockdown period, which allowed us to do quite a lot of outreach since it was done also virtually. So we had the pleasure of not doing the travel, that we could reach more people. And through all the events and everything that we did, we reached more than 90 countries. The standard is addressed at an audience that doesn't typically respond to all the EDs from the IAASB. So we did more to make sure that we also hear from people that we ordinarily don't hear from. That included also having surveys through IFAC, having a separate survey on the ED, and also we received more than 145 comment letters, which at that point was a record-breaking number for an ED in IAASB. We also did conferences. We've had three rounds of Paris conference. The last one was in May 2022, where we gave some insights into what we heard in the ED and how we're planning to address that. In that conference, we had more than 130 participants covering more than 33 jurisdictions. So if we go to the next slide. So what did we hear on the ED itself? So I said, with the number of responses and the engagement that we got both in the written responses survey and the outreach, it shows that there is an enormous interest. What we did here is that there is a global need and there's an urgent global need. The increasing risk of fragmentation and the increasing complexity is a concern from the respondents on the ED itself. So that's, we've taken that forward, and we'll give you more insights on how we're addressing the issues we heard in the ED. What we did here is that we got great support for how the standard is structured and the flow and the innovative approaches that we took in some areas. The standard is designed to follow the flow of the audit, which it was helpful, and people found it easy to understand, and it was more directive, more direct in order to what you need to do, which also could be helpful in what you need to document, and it's clear to see what to do. You may remember that we, in the reporting area, for example, did something different than we had in the ISAS to help understand the requirements and be more directive to find the right areas. There were different views on the ED, some of which we'll hear about today. But one of the clear calls we heard is that stakeholders expected greater difference from what you have in the ISAS, and that we got feedback that the ED was too close to the ISAS from what the respondents said. And so some said there is a little benefit of using the standard itself, which called, they also gave input into specific areas where there are opportunities to further differentiate and give us some helpful tips on how we could address that to be more proportionate to the audits of LCs. Some of those areas include risk identification and assessment, quality management, and one of the always the issues that comes back is around documentation that we're also trying to address. We did hear feedback on the authority itself, on the standard as well. That's who can use the standard. We got some specific areas there, or specific feedback on areas where we had scoped out, which respondents disagreed with. So there was a call to put back more on estimates. As you hear more about today as well, around groups, and as you may have seen that we released a separate ED on how to do group audits under this standard. So with that, I'll hand over to Amy, that will take us a little bit more into the details of what we heard and how we're progressing the issues further.
Thanks, Kai. So as you noted, I'm going to cover some of the more pervasive themes heard from respondents in a little bit more detail. So I'll start with the nature and the design of the standard. It's somewhat interwoven, so I'll cover it together. So a pervasive theme of respondents' comments was that the stakeholders were unclear about the overall nature of the draft standard, and that was driven somewhat by confusion over what type of entity would qualify as an LCE. In other words, there was different ideas about what type of audit the standard might be used on, and so respondents wanted some clarification on that. Although there was some mixed views, the majority of respondents agreed with using the ISAs as a basis for the requirements themselves, but still felt that the standard needed to be further differentiated. As Kai just mentioned, for them to provide value as based on the exposed draft, it really felt too similar. So there was support for using the ISAs, just looking at how it could also be further differentiated. There was broad support for it being a self-contained, so a standalone standard. So in other words, it's an alternative to the ISAs, it's not an addition. So it contains everything an auditor needs to do the audit without going to the ISAs. Respondents did question if there was enough guidance contained in the standard, and also if it would be possible to use the ISAs if an area of more complexity comes up, for example, an accounting estimate. So we are going to cover that in a bit more detail later on. As Kai noted also, respondents really liked the structure of the standard, how it was structured to follow the flow of the audit with a more direct language, and really liked some of the innovative approaches that we took, for example, utilising tables for our presentations on reporting requirements within part 9 of the exposure draft. Moving on to authority, and that's the part which describes who the standard is used, is designed for, so it's the scope. Linked to the earlier comment, respondents really wanted us to better describe who the standard is for in this document and be clear about what a typical less complex entity is and make the authority easier to use and implement, as it felt too open and involved too much judgment. And finally, groups. We did receive a strong steer, as Kai mentioned, to include less complex group audits in the scope of the standard, with suggestions how they can be included and presented. So those were really the key themes. So if we move on to the next slide. So how have the IAASB been looking to tackle the comments heard? So our next few slides are going to give us an overview of the discussions that we've had as a board since the exposure draft. So I will remind you that the revisions have not been finalised or voted on by the board, but this is really meant to give you an idea of the direction of travel at this point, give you an idea of the discussions that we've had. So starting with the authority, so prohibitions. So this is the list of prohibitions where the standard just can't be used. As already mentioned, we propose to remove the blanket prohibition for group audits, and we're instead proposing to allow some group audits, and we'll cover that in more detail later. In terms of the qualitative characteristics, so these are the characteristics that an auditor would assess against when determining if an entity is a less complex entity for the purposes of using the standard. And we've discussed some revisions to individual characteristics here to better reflect what a typical less complex entity is. So it now describes what is less complex rather than more complex. And we've tried to be more direct and specific in terms of the characteristics themselves to make them kind of easier to use and interpret. So moving on to quantitative thresholds, and in the exposure draft, it was noted that the relevant authorities in individual jurisdictions could add on additional considerations to the authority to make it appropriate for their jurisdiction when they take it and implement it. For the jurisdiction. So for example, they could add on additional prohibitions, classes of entities, and determine their own quantitative thresholds. So for example, setting a revenue number or employee number or similar or both over which the entity may just simply not be a less complex entity at that point and shouldn't use. So based on the comments from respondents, the board discussed quantitative thresholds a little bit more. And have discussed making this more prominent in the authority. So in other words, an expectation for jurisdictions to determine quantitative thresholds that might make sense for their jurisdiction. And so we've discussed including further guidance and examples to assist in this determination. Finally, we've also discussed some other changes to the authority, such as describing key topics that are not included. So, yeah, relying on the use of internal audit, for example, just to make that clearer up front in the authority, and also adding clarifying guidance as respondents requested, just in areas that wasn't clear. So that was the key changes around authority that we've discussed so far. We'll mention in the exposure draft, which we'll be talking about a little bit later with regards groups, there is a bit more detail in there. About what we've discussed in terms of changes to the authority and the individual characteristics so far as the board. So it gives you a bit more flavour. So if we move on to the next slide. So developing proportionate revisions to the standard. So given the pervasive theme in this area, the board has also been discussing how we address that respondent comment and how to kind of develop more proportionate requirements, particularly in key areas identified by respondents. We've been discussing targeting revisions, particularly to the key areas such as risk identification and assessment and understanding control, internal control. These were big areas noted for respondents where we could do more to further differentiate from the ISAs and be more proportionate, be more tailored to a typical LCE. Also, areas such as quality management and audit documentation, audit planning, some of those areas were highlighted as things that we should look at first and in focus. So the board have discussed looking at these areas and really evaluating if the requirements are relevant and proportional to a typical LCE. So looking through these requirements and evaluating if they make sense, could we approach it in a different way, considering the matters and circumstances of the entities that are under audit and would be under audit when using this standard. One example is reviewing if we need the granularity of the requirements there of what is and exactly included, and could some things move towards into guidance so we can focus more on the outcome of what the requirement is instead of kind of having to walk through exactly everything that needs to be done and how to do it within the requirement itself. So to provide a more specific example, talking about the understanding of the entity system of internal control. So respondents noted that LCEs typically have a less formalized and less complex process, in particular the entity's risk assessment process and monitoring of their controls. Therefore, we've looked at if we can structure this section to reflect that. So do we need a detailed understanding and evaluation of every component of internal control as laid out in ISA 315? Separately, or is there a different approach? So thinking about entities' risk assessment process or process for monitoring controls, rather than having a requirement to formally understand and evaluate these separately, could these now be inquiries which are more direct? So talking to management about how you identify and assess risks relevant to the preparation of the financial statements, or for monitoring, how management involves, how do they identify controls are not working? So really kind of better reflecting how the conversation would actually take place in a typical LCE. Similarly, picking another focus area, quality management, we've been discussing if it, be clearer how quality management may be different where it's a smaller team or it's a sole practitioner, so there's just one person working on the engagement, which might be better suited to a typical LCE. So how can we make it clearer in that circumstances versus a larger team? So they're just some of the things that we've been discussing as a board. Of course, we'll also be adding additional EEM where appropriate too. So moving on to the next slide, I'm going to pass it over to Jasper, who's going to talk a little bit more about a few areas of revisions discussed.
Thank you, Amy, and thank you everyone for attending this webinar as well. So on starting with accounting estimates, so what we heard back from the exposure draft are basically two messages that are a bit opposite from each other. So on one hand, respondents were of the view that the requirements and guidance for accounting estimates could be simplified. This is to the point that Amy and Kai raised that to have a greater difference between the ISAs and the ISA for LCE. But then on the other hand, respondents wanted to include more complex estimates in the scope of the ISA for LCE. In that regard, it was noted that complexity in an accounting estimate is not necessarily an indicator of complexity for the entity more broadly. And it was also noted that a typical LCE may have one or a small number of accounting estimates that may be deemed more complex. And in that regard, we received a lot of examples, for example, an inventory provision, investment property, as one of the examples. So, and then another main message was that the description of a complex accounting estimate included in the qualitative characteristics in the authority was difficult to apply. So what have we done on this? And in that regard, I have to say that we are still working on this. So we've kind of settled on the authority and the direction we're going, but we're still working on the specific requirements, and we'll bring that to the board in March. On the authority, so we revised the qualitative characteristic for an accounting estimate, and it now reads as follows. The entity's financial statements typically do not include accounting estimates that involve the use of complex methods or models, assumptions, or data. So what we did is we used more direct language, focusing on the methods, models, assumptions, or data, And this wording is more in line with what's also being used in ISO 440 revised. And we hope therefore that it's easier to apply for users of the standard. But the main change is that we allow the use of the standard when there are some accounting estimates that are more complex. And this is signaled because we use the word typically. And the board is comfortable with this because there are other checks and balances that exist in the standard and that are shown on this slide. So for example, there are other changes that complex estimates are significantly reduced, for example, by the prohibitions and limitations. So for example, banks and insurance companies are not allowed to use the standard. And there are the other qualitative characteristics. And these matters really drive entities that are more complex out of the standard. And the other thing that's important to note is that the auditor's evaluation on whether there are complex estimates is made on the overall nature and type of accounting estimate held by the entity. So there is no need for a detailed analysis of every accounting estimate that is held during the client's acceptance and continuance, because we thought it wouldn't be practical. Like, it's hard for a practitioner to know what exactly the accounting estimates are for a company. So on the requirements, as noted, we're still working on this. So we reviewed the requirements in the ISO for LCE related to accounting estimates. We come with some proposals to the board in March. So I cannot say much about it right now, but I think it just really high level, I will say that in general, I think there will be some more requirements in EEM on accounting estimates, given that the standard now also allows for more complex accounting estimates for entities that have more complex accounting estimates to use the standard as well. So therefore, there will be some more requirements in EEM in the standard. But we'll see where we land with that one on the with the board in March. If we go to the next slide, we go to the topic of group audits. As both Amy and Kai has mentioned already, like there used to be a prohibition for the use of the ISO for LCE for group audits. And we heard really strong support for the inclusion of group audits in the scope of the standard. And the main reasons for that were that not including the group audits could reduce the use of the standard significantly. And also that group structures can be simple. Like, and there again, we received a lot of examples of group structures that are simple. And respondents also highlighted to us that the IAASB recently revised ISO 600, and ISO 600 revised clarifies the scope of what is a group audit. And because of this clarification, more audits are considered to be group audit right now. So for example, all entities with branches or divisions are a group audit. So that will quite quickly could include LCEs as well. So the board was of the view that that the prohibition on group audits should be removed. And we had a thorough discussion on the inclusion of component auditors. And this might, I want to highlight a little bit more background for you on. So on one hand, the board recognizes that the use of component auditor does not necessarily mean complexity. For example, if a component auditor does an inventory count, because the inventory is located in a different location, and that doesn't add a lot of complexity. But on the other hand, the board also realized that when there are more component auditors, it does get more complex, the audit, and it also questions whether really the entity is not as complex anymore. This is also, we also looked at this given the general concerns about the scope of the standard that was highlighted before as well by Amy and Kai. So where did we land? On balance, the IAASB was of the view that the use of component auditors should be prohibited. However, there's one exception noted in that. So, and that is when the component auditor's involvement is limited to circumstances in which a physical presence is needed for a specific audit procedure. And an example of that, of a physical presence is needed for a specific audit procedure, is, for example, when the auditor is attending a physical inventory count or inspecting physical assets. So the board is thus, for those specific kind of procedures, the board opened up the use of component auditors as well. Then in the authority, you also added qualitative characteristics for a group audit. And these are in addition to the qualitative characteristics for a single entity. So an entity needs to pass all the or needs to apply with all the qualitative characteristics for a single entity, and then in addition needs to comply with the qualitative characteristics for a group. And we added the following qualitative characteristics: the group structure and activities. And hereby you can think about the number of entities, business units, and the number of jurisdictions that the entity is involved in. And also the another qualitative characteristic is the access to information and people and the consolidation process. On the development of part 10, like the actual requirements and EEM that we developed, we have it in the separate part because there are several reasons given to keep the body of the proposed standard more streamlined and easier to use. Also to make it easier for auditors of group audits to see all the relevant additional requirements in one place. And also it makes it easier to exclude part 10 if a jurisdiction decides not to allow the ISO for LCE for a group audit. We based it on what's in ISO 600 revised and the exposure draft on the group audits was published in January and is open for comments till May 2nd of this year. If we move to the last slide, I'll give you a quick overview on the way forward. So in March, we will discuss a large part of the standard. As you may be aware, we discussed the authority already with the board last year. And this year, in March, we will discuss parts 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, last on 7 only when it relates to accounting estimates. So it's a significant part of the standard. And then in June, we hope to present a full standard to the board for discussion. In the meanwhile, as I mentioned, like we have in May, the exposure period for group audits ends. We will analyze the results and discuss the results and a way forward with the board in September 2023. And then by the end of this year, in December, we hope to approve the standards. It will then be published in the spring of 2024 because we first need to get approval from the PIOB that due process is followed. On the effective date, we haven't discussed that yet, and which we will do in due course with the board. And with that, Paul, maybe I hand it over to you for the questions and answers.
Indeed, thank you so much, Jasper, Kai, Amy. Fabulous presentation. You know what, we've been inundated in the Q&A. I have tried to, as quickly as possible, scramble quick responses to as many questions as I could. But inevitably, we're not necessarily going to find time to go through all of them. But let me get started very quickly, if I may, with some of the key issues that are kind of coming up through the questions. I mean, the first question, and I guess really this is for you, Kai, or the others, if you want to weigh in, is what are you seeing as the key benefits of this standard and using this standard rather than the full suite of ISAs?
Thank you, Paul. I did touch on this briefly, or some of this briefly in the beginning. I think by having a global standard, I think it's a really good response, and I think it's to reduce the risk of having fragmentation and having different standards around that would be of different quality. I think one of the primary expected benefits is to have a standard that would enable consistent performance of quality audits through the requirements that are adapted to the circumstances of less complex entities itself. We do that through having clear requirements to create a consistent understanding of what needs to be done, going more direct to what needs to be done. And I think that is particularly helpful with regards to documentation, which is an issue that seems to be coming back, feedback we're getting throughout. That will also help regulators and audit oversight bodies in monitoring activities to know we have a standard that's more clear on what needs to be done and document. I think it also will help you in inspections to be more have a more common understanding what's relevant to audits of LCEs as well. I think some of the other could be also that we're through having this, we may get some lessons learned that we could also get into the ISOs themselves. And I think also in some of the outreach we did hear a strong message that having this standard would help the profession to develop and sustainability throughout the world, and especially also was highlighted by World Bank that developing nations it could be help to promote economy development in certain of those areas as well. So it's not it could grow the market for audit even more than what we currently have. So Amy, I don't know if you want to add something to that.
Yeah, and I know we've got a lot of questions, so I'll try and be brief. I think, you know, maybe from a more practical level, and as being a, you know, an ex-auditor many years ago of a number of these engagements, I think for me, it's really, you know, if we can get the scope of the standard right, then we can really develop those requirements that are what matters for a less complex entity. And so, you know, from an auditor point of view, you can really focus on what matters. And we did get some of that feedback back from the exposure draft as well, that, you know, without having to filter and, you know, document and talk about things that just aren't relevant, instead focusing on the risky areas and what matters, I think is a key benefit for the auditor, but also, of course, for the client and the wider ecosystem, because I think you can achieve a better, you know, high quality audit when you're able to focus on the things that are really important for these type of entities. So that's really the main thing I was going to add on top of what you said, Kai.
Thank you so much. And you've just raised the issue of quality, Amy. One of the big concerns that's come through the questions that have been posed today, but also I think previously from stakeholders, is with this being a separate standard, is there a risk that this standard is going to be perceived as audit light, a kind of a second tier standard that isn't offering the same level of audit quality as the full suite of ISAs? And of course, that could also cause the fraction of the profession, a two-tier profession, perhaps. Kai, whether you want to try to tackle that one, that's quite a tough question, I think.
Yeah, it is a tough question, but it's a concern that we've heard from stakeholders in the ED and also in the outreach leading up to this. And it's really important that we get the messaging right. And when I also say we, it's not only about IAASB, EFAA, IFAC and others. It's also for national institutes and so on, and auditors themselves to message what this really is about. What was the objective of this, developing this standard, is to have a high quality audit. Have no confessions on quality compared to the ISAs, but it's built specifically for this purpose. So some of the concerns we heard earlier, we will work with others to get the messaging right, to say that it's not about lowering the quality or having any shortcuts, but it's getting, I think as Amy alluded to as well, going more straight to what are the issues. I think through the ISAs, there may be requirements that may not be particularly relevant to these type of audits that we could would not need to include, and also that there may be a different way to get to the end goal. The objective and goal is to have same level of assurance. So it's getting that messaging right is an important task, and we are working with the professional accountants, the organizations, and the national standard setters, regulators, and so on, to get them to agree, understand, and agree on that messaging as well. So we need to get the scope right, but we also need to get the messaging through that this is not about having an easier audit. It's getting there with the standards designed for the purpose.
So in effect, what you're saying, Kai, is that obviously local regulators, standard setters, professional accountancy organizations, these guys have quite a crucial role in helping to disseminate awareness of this standard, who is eligible to use it, and of course deciding for themselves how it might be used in their own jurisdiction. You know, we've got a number of questions coming through about who's sort of eligible to use it and so on. Obviously, the standard does provide some guidance as to what type of entity this is targeted at. But in terms of where this thing sits, whether or not it can be used in a particular jurisdiction really does come down to the task of the local regulator to decide. Okay, that's great. You will notice, those of you that are posing questions using the Q&A function, that IAASB, that our triumvirate from the IAASB, are hard at work trying to respond to as many questions as possible. One other issue that is coming up is, if you're a small or medium-sized practice right now, let's imagine that you do provide audits of small businesses or less complex businesses, you're using the full suite of IFAs. How should you be responding? How should you be preparing for the release of this standard? And perhaps, Monica, this might be a good question for you to tackle.
Thanks, Paul. And certainly this is not a simple answer to the point. The key aspect to be considered is about understanding the entity, understanding the company that will be audited, and using some information that Kai, Jasper, and Amy already addressed. This standard does not mean less quality. On the opposite, it is so much based on the ISAs themselves, considering proportionality, scalability aspects, and considering especially circumstances that, as was just mentioned, are not relevant. So how SMPs are supposed to deal with that? In the same way that SMPs need to understand and apply ISAs in clients in general, once the standard is approved, a role of the SMP to understand the client and to see if the client applies to use the LCE. So this is something that it's not a 1 + 1 = 2. This is not something so simple. But considering the circumstances, that this might mean from quantitative and qualitative aspect to define that. And just to reinforce what you just mentioned, this is not something that will come ready purely from the standard. So this is something that needs to have an involvement, jurisdictional involvement, to make sure that the criteria or the guidelines to consider that the specific LCE standard can be applied to that profile of the entity really is applicable. So at the end of the day, SMPs need to understand the standard, need to know how to use it, and need to use appropriate technical criteria and appropriate judgment to define if the standard is applicable to that client. What we know is that mainly in the SME environment, there are a lot of non-complex entities. So.
Thank you so much, Monica. Great insights. You know, one of the questions that I'm seeing quite a lot on the screen in front of me relates to, what is the audit report using this standard look like? How is it going to differ to what one would read in the audit report where one has used the full suite of ISAs? Not really sure who might wants to take that one on. It's a bit of a free-for-all for you guys.
Yeah, I can start. As I said earlier, the standard is designed to come out with the same level of assurance. So the words, the meaning behind your words will be the same. It would look somewhat similar. It's also a little bit hard to respond directly. People can look into the ED, what we saw there. We didn't get any strong reactions to what we had, but we haven't discussed how to progress it further. And there may be maybe changes that need to be done, but main thing is, yes, it will come with the same level of assurance, so readers of the report should have the same level of trust.
Thank you. And one final question, and I think I'll shoot this over to you, Jasper, if I may. This is great that we've got a standalone scalable standard for less complex entities. But does that mean that the IAASB has given up on the task of trying to make the full suite of ISAs more scalable and proportional?
Thank you, Paul, for that question. I don't think the IAASB will stop with making the full set of ISAs also more scalable. There will be some jurisdictions that don't adapt the ISA for LCE, so there will still be ISA LCE audits that will be performed using the ISAs. So I think in that regard, it's important to highlight our project or our guidance on CUSP, and CUSP stands for complexity, understandability, scalability, and proportionality. And all new standards that we are developing, they go through such a review. There are, of course, still the pressures that Kai highlighted in the beginning, of course, from regulators to include more in our standards, but it is focused. I will keep continuing to focus on CUSP as well for our existing standards.
That's great. Thanks, Jasper. And thanks to all of you for participating in this panel discussion and for the presentation that you gave preceding that. It's now time for a few final closing remarks. I mean, let me first of all apologize for not having got around to answer all of your questions. I think we could have gone on all day and all night for some, but I hope you, like me, found the event fascinating, timely, and useful. I have to thank you, the audience, so many of you, for joining us and for being so engaged, for helping make it a great success. Looking forward, it's now time to start preparing for the publication of the ISA for LCE this December and its issue soon after in Q1 of 2024. If not many get round to using this thing, we would have failed in this venture. So collectively, we must get behind IFAC and the IAASB and help them disseminate and promote use of the standard as far as we can. We've got to ensure that regulators, professional bodies, SMPs, SMEs, the wider public understand that this standard will provide the basis for an audit of equivalent quality to an audit performed using the full suite of ISAs. And we must make every effort to ensure the standard is and is seen to be less rigorous than the ISAs. Rather, it's a standard tailored to fit different types of entity, a less complex entity. And we must make every effort to communicate, to explain, to promote the value and benefits of an LCE or SME audit. On screen, you'll see, thank you very much, Jasmine, a final screen with some resources and references. And I'd also like to invite all of you to join us virtually for the EFAA International Conference 2023 on the 25th of May, which will be focused on the future of small practice, attracting, retaining, and reskilling talent. Please check out EFAA.com for more information. Thank you for listening and good day.
Thanks so much, Paul. I think we can probably close it now, Jasmine. Thanks so much to the presenters. Really great session.